Learn about some of the new performance capabilities in SQL Server 2022 this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Pedro from the SQL Server team. Pedro, thanks so much for joining us today.
Hi, Anna. My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. It's a pleasure to have you on the show, and I'm excited to continue our discussion about SQL Server 2022. Pedro, for folks who haven't been tuning into the series, I would encourage you to go do so. But for folks who haven't, can you tell us a little bit about, you know, what SQL Server 2022 is all about?
Yes. So if you have watched Bob Ward's short presentation on the overall overview of SQL Server 2022, you've seen that one of the main topics and the main areas of investment is connectivity to Azure and bringing in the power of Azure to your local database. However, we are also, as we've done in previous versions, investing heavily on additional security features, performance, and scalability. And today I'm here to talk to you about some of the performance features that we are putting into this new version of SQL Server.
Awesome, cool. What are some of those new capabilities?
So we start with Query Store. Now, Query Store is not new, right? But the way we're using Query Store is new. Query Store was introduced back in SQL Server 2016 as we told you back then, as a flight recorder for your query performance. And we have a system that gathers query performance data and allows you to have insights over your workloads over time. Now we are using that to actually build new capabilities in intelligent query processing. But for that, we need to clean house a little bit to make sure that, for example, that Query Store is now enabled by default for new databases. And that's something that's brand new in SQL Server 2022. The other thing that's brand new is also we're adding support for secondary replicas in Query Store. In other words, until now, Query Store only collected data from workloads running in the primary replica of an always-on availability group topology. Now, we're bringing in support to also collect that query performance data from secondary replicas. And this, together with another feature that's not mentioned here, which is the ability to have hinting support directly in Query Store, will allow us to build new intelligent query processing scenarios and bring better capabilities into the performance space.
Awesome, cool. So when we talk about intelligent query processing, I know it's kind of been a journey. Can you tell us like a little bit about that journey and maybe a few of the highlights that are coming new to SQL Server 2022?
It's a big journey, as you see on the screen here. The tree is getting larger and larger. We started very timidly back in SQL Server 2017, as you see highlighted in blue there, with adaptive query processing. And then we expanded the family of features and the scenarios that we are tackling in SQL Server 2019. And intelligent query processing was something we coined back then, bringing in scalability of inlining and batch mode for row store. Now, and this has always been present in Azure SQL Database because it's the same database engine that powers both SQL Server and Azure SQL Database. And Azure SQL Database is also typically some months or years ahead of SQL Server in terms of any major new feature. So now we're bringing in another addition to this tree. And you see there in white boxes and bold, some new features that tackle new scenarios or existing scenarios, I might say, that are new in this automated intelligent query processing family.
Awesome, cool. So just to pick a few, I mean, all of these seem very interesting to me, but the first one that catches my eye is CE feedback. Can you tell me like what that is and how it would relate to, say, someone moving from SQL Server 2012?
Well, that's an excellent question, because if you are moving from an older version that's reaching end of life next year, like SQL Server 2012, then what happens is you're using something that is usually dubbed as the old CE or old cardinality estimation model. Now, when you move to newer versions starting in 2014 and above, we have newer versions of these cardinality estimation models, which are dubbed the new CEs, right? So what happens is when you leap over versions from 2012 all the way to 2022, there is the possibility that in some cases, there is workload that might regress in terms of performance. So what we're doing here is we've accumulated years of experience working with customers that have tackled these scenarios coming from old versions to new versions. And we are putting those lessons into this feature, into CE feedback, so that when we detect that certain types of workloads regress, we are able to automatically experiment, try out new or different model assumptions and see if those work better. And if they do, we'll make them persisted in QueryStore so that they start getting used going forward. So in essence, it's like query tuning completely automated without you having to be a query performance expert, essentially.
Wow, very cool. Okay, so moving right along, because I know we want to get to a demo. DOP feedback. I'm guessing this has to do with degree of parallelism. What's the Absolutely. Feedback side?
Absolutely. So what is the feedback side of this? Now, another classic problem that some SQL Server workloads face, which is you set a DOP configuration at the server level or at the database level, and then depending on whether a query goes parallel or not, it will typically reach that degree of parallelism. However, we know that some queries do better with less when they execute in less processors. Some queries actually work better when they have more processors being attached to the execution of that query. For example, an analytical query, right? So what we're able to do here is, starting from that initial degree of parallelism, that's a default, whatever you set, we'll detect whether your queries are running with optimal parallelism, and we derive that from a certain number of signals that we'll go into further detail in the documentation. And then we're able to see if it's not using parallelism efficiently, we can start dropping the degree of parallelism for every single query that enters that space, and until it reaches a point where it's using parallelism more efficiently. In essence, this means that you have more efficient use of parallelism in your server. That means that you can run your workloads in a much smoother way, and they become more scalable overall.
Awesome. Very cool. Another awesome capability. Very cool. I can't wait to test it out. The other one I wanted to ask about is in the space of memory grant feedback. Can you tell us about this new update here?
Right. What I will bring in. So one, memory grant feedback resolved a lot of issues with customer workloads that were misusing memory. And that was introduced in SQL Server 2017. And then we completed the scope or the applicability of that scenario in SQL Server 2019 when it applied to row mode workloads as well. So it applies to every single query potentially. However, one major piece of feedback we always got is, hey, if I need to fail over, if I need to restart my SQL Server instance, all those lessons are gone. All the feedback that was accrued and all the changes and the tweaks that were done to my queries are just gone. It has to relearn again. And that typically during that learning phase, you're not running, let's say, at an optimal condition from a memory usage perspective. So what we're bringing in is the ability to actually persist that feedback, persist the memory grant feedback values and lessons. And that means that when you fail over, when you restart and the query comes back up, it will reuse the values for optimal memory grants that were there before. So that takes away that learning phase, that reset behavior that we had before.
Awesome. Wow. And it's always cool to see how all these capabilities, you're building them basically based on the feedback that we get from some customers. So that's always great to see. I know there's a few other things on here. Parameter sensitive plan is really piquing my interest, but I'll let you decide what you want to talk about next.
Let's jump to that, because I have a demo on this one. Now, parameter-sensitive plans are known also by another name, the name of the, let's say, the problem they may generate, which is parameter sniffing issues. Now, being sensitive to parameters is something that helps SQL Server, because it uses those parameters that are incoming for every parameterized query, such as a stored procedure, to actually create a query plan that should be optimal for that specific parameter that's incoming. However, there's another characteristic of the SQL engine, which is to cache the first plan that's created for these parameterized queries. Now, what this means is, if your first execution was not, let's say, the bulk of the executions you make of a certain type of parameterized query, that means that the first execution is skewed. The first execution has a plan that's good for that one, but may not be good for all the bulk of the executions that you make of that stored procedure. So That leads to parameter sniffing issues, as it's commonly named in the community. And we are optimizing that space to make sure that that's no longer a problem for the 80% case. And I have a demo on that. You would like to see that?
Oh, I would love to see that.
All right. Then let's jump into the PSP demo. All right. So what I have here is SQL Server 2022. And you know that it's SQL Server 2022 because if I do this and execute, you'll see that I'm indeed running in the CTP1 version of SQL Server 2022. So this is just hot off the presses. And I want to show you, like we just mentioned, the parameter sensitive plan scenario. So for this, I'm going to use the database property MLS. Essentially, this is a database for a real estate company. And that real estate company has a number of properties in their portfolio. And they have a number of agents working for them. And each agent has their portfolio of properties they are trying to sell to customers, right? So in this database, there is one stored procedure called property search by agent. In essence, what it does, let's look at the definition of this stored procedure. What it does is it takes an agent ID, which is an integer, and then it gets all the data from the property data, from the property table, regarding all the portfolio that that agent has, like the property ID, the agent ID, the MLS link ID, and then the listing price, the zip code where it's at, how many bedrooms, how many bathrooms, and there are other properties I'm not bringing in here. Now, what happens is, this being a parameterized query, depending on the agent ID, has the potential of generating different plans, because depending on the agent ID, I may have a lot more properties being returned by the result set than with using other agent IDs. So if I look at the statistics for this plan, specifically on the agent ID column of the property table, using the CSDMDB stats histogram, what I see is that, so as I output the histogram, I see there are a number of agent IDs. Those are in this range high key column. And I can see how many rows, how many properties those agents have. Now, I see a couple of agents here, agents one and two, that have almost 500,000 properties, right? And then there are a few others that have either in the dozens. And if I start scrolling down, I don't see it here, but I have a few that are in the hundreds. So this right here is where we derive, we're starting to see a bit of the internals of this feature. Because we use these histograms to understand what is the potential for, in a certain incoming parameter, to potentially generate widely different plans depending on the number of rows that would be returned. So what I've done here on the side, because this takes a while and I've done this before, is I've executed that stop procedure with agent ID 2. Now, agent ID 2, if we go back here, has approximately 500,000 rows, right? So, oh no, I'm sorry, 5,000,000 rows, that's what I meant. It has approximately 5,000,000 rows. And so if I look at this first execution, I see that the plan that was generated was a parallel cluster index scan, there was a sort, and then this was returned. If I look at the properties for this specific query, I can see that it executed in roughly 2 minutes. So it takes quite a while, right? Now, in a classic SQL Server, what would happen is this would be the plan that would be used for every single execution, even the ones, even when I use parameters like agent ID 9 or 11 that I only have a handful of properties. And doing a scan over this very large table would be very inefficient. Now, because this feature exists, PSP feedback, when I executed the same sort of procedure with a parameter ID 4 or 8, which return a lot less rows, I can see that the plan is different. I can see that it's a plan that's much more attuned to returning 3 rows in this case and to also returning 3 rows in this other case. And if I go to the other agent ID, it returns 9 rows. And it reuses the same plan as agent ID 4. Now, what does this, all this means? This means that we have simultaneously in the plan cache, in at least two plans for the same query, they coexist in the cache, they're active plans. And depending on the incoming parameter that comes in for this repeated query, we'll use one plan or the other, and we don't have to recompile, which was a classic technique to handle this, and they are always in the cache. Now, the proof is in the pudding, as they say. So let's look here. If I look at the cached plans, I can see that I have two plans for the same query text. This is exactly the same query text here. And one was used one time, which was the first with parameter ID, with the agent ID 2. And then I have another one that was used six times. Remember that I have three executions of each of these incoming parameters, 4 and 8. So if you want to see further proof, let's go further, deeper in this. I can actually look also at the query stats, so performance stats for these queries, and why it's so important to have these active plans being simultaneously in the cache. Because if I look here, so the same six executions, one execution of the other one, I see two things. I see one, the total worker time. In other words, the CPU time. One execution of the sub procedure with agent ID 2 took manifold, many times more CPU time than six executions of the other plan. And when I said that these are different plans for the same query, this is what you can see. You have the same query hash. The query hash is, let's say, the fingerprint that uniquely identifies this query in your server, but they have different query plan hashes. So they have different query plans cached and active to return a different result set. And I can see the last time this query was executed with this plan, so the one that's faster, took returned 9 rows. This one, the one with agent ID 2, returned almost 5 million. So there you have it. We have essentially, for the 80% case, solved this very tough case of parameter sensitivity.
Awesome. Wow, Pedro, this is really cool to see. And I love to see in a real world example like this, how parameter sensitive plan optimization is going to work. You've shown us so much that's coming with SQL Server 2022. I just want to thank you for coming on the show. For our viewers, I want to thank you for tuning in. We're going to put links in the description so you can go try this out yourself, apply for the early adopter program, see other information related to this. And if you like this video, go ahead and give it a like, subscribe to our channel, leave us a comment, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.
Thank you, everyone.